to Studio 10. Well, Wayne Swan was federal treasurer in a time of incredible economic and political upheaval. During the global financial crisis, he helped steer the nation away from recession while dealing with the deep divisions within the Labor Party. He has a fascinating perspective on it all, and he's promised to be very frank in our next interview. Please welcome him to our studio. It's Wayne Swan, everyone. Swan, welcome.
Hey, Sonny, how are you?
Morning, Wayne.
He spent six years as treasurer. Maybe should have gone into diplomacy.
Yeah, I'm thinking about that. Perhaps Ida can teach me.
Ah, now, Wayne. Come on, we go back a fair way.
But look, we do, yeah.
You write in the book, you know, being the treasurer is what's important.
It's a privilege.
It gives you a unique perspective. Did you think you were a pretty good treasurer?
Look, I'll leave that judgment to others, but I was Finance Minister of the Year. The only other time that honour has been received here was by Paul Keating. I think our country performed spectacularly well during the global financial crisis. And if you look at what people said about our stimulus, how it was evaluated by economists and others around the world, it got the very big tick. So I'm very proud of what our country achieved, because it wasn't just what I did. It's what the business community did. It's what the trade unions did. We all came together. Mm. And the end result was a million extra jobs over that six-year period.
But I think the thing that's always going to haunt you, isn't it, or were all the budget surpluses you promised but weren't able to deliver?
Yeah, but we had a very big fiscal consolidation, but it is true. We didn't get to surplus when we hoped to get the surplus, and I went out and spoke about why that happened. I paid a pretty big political price for that, but I'd rather pay a political price than an economic price, because if we would have kept that target, then at the end of the day we would have lost more jobs, and it was the responsible thing to do at the time, and I've talked about that pretty frankly in the book.
I think the government does deserve credit for getting us through the GFC. I think it is a genuinely extraordinary result that while other countries are still suffering from the after effects of depression, really, not even just recession, that...
And look at Europe today.
That we are doing so well. But I think that what troubles people is, I guess, a lack of frankness about it. You were holding out, you were promising surpluses when everyone else towards the end was saying there's no way that's going to happen, and even if it was going to happen, you should just say, you know what, the cuts would be too deep. Have you been troubled by, I suppose, a lack of willingness to admit when you haven't got things right?
No, I went out and said, we're not going to make it. I explained the reasons
why. Very belatedly, though.
No, not really. I mean, it was a very important target to have, because we were Keynesians on the way down. We moved to protect the economy. We stimulated it when global demand fell off a cliff. And I had the very firm view that when the economy was recovering, we should consolidate. There was a very substantial consolidation that we put in place. Unfortunately, revenues kept dropping. And this remains the problem today with the budget.
Yeah.
The budget today doesn't have a problem because of spending. It's got a problem because, unexpectedly, our revenues have dropped dramatically. And that's a very big issue right now.
Step in there. I mean, reading your book, it's very difficult to know who did what and who did it best. I mean, Kevin Rudd, the former Prime Minister, seemed to take most of the credit for steering us through the GFC. In your book, you claim a fair bit of that credit.
Oh, I give Kevin a lot of credit as well, but we worked together. And what I try to explain in the book is how we worked together, because despite all of the other issues of leadership that haunted our government, Kevin did a good job through that period.
How is your relationship with Kevin Rudd now?
Look, I don't have a great relationship with Kevin. And
but how did it fall apart?
Well, you couldn't write the book without being frank about it.
No, you were very frank. I almost fell off my table chair when I was reading The Good Weekend.
Sure.
Saw the extract.
Sure, but if you're going to explain your successes, then you have to talk about your challenges and your problems. And I've had a very long relationship with Kevin, and I go to great lengths to explain that relationship.
He was godfather to one of your children. Yeah.
Many
friends.
Many years ago, you know, 20-odd years ago.
But, you know, when I was reading the extract, it seemed to me that Kevin Rudd must have always had these idiosyncrasies about the way he worked. Weren't you on alert from having known him before in Queensland? I mean, was it only apparent once he was the Prime Minister and you were the Treasurer?
Well, we don't all get to choose who we work with. And we all work with a lot of people, and we work around them sometimes. I knew him much better than anyone else. We did work successfully together during the global financial crisis.
That's right.
But I then, in the book, go through and explain how that unravelled and why.
But why don't you like him?
Well, Kevin and I had a relationship that goes back a long way, and we work closely together. But in life, we always have fallings out with people. But I don't...
Well, what happened? I mean, did he tell you you were a crummy treasurer?
Well, it was all about whether we were good policymakers. It wasn't about my personal view about Kevin or his personal view about me. And, of course, I explain in the book the policy issues that led to the outcome. It is a complete mistake just to take one small part of the book and not read it in total. And I'm not saying you've done that, but I would urge people to read the book in total because what it really explains...
I still can't see how when you had this close relationship, and there was a friendship clearly in the beginning, and then there was the close partnership as you steered the country through the GFC.
Yeah.
But I have to think something happened for you two. I mean, you were very frank in your assessment of him.
Exactly, because he fell out, if you like, with a whole range of his colleagues for a whole range of reasons. And the book goes through all of those in detail. And I had great difficulty putting that down, but unless you explain that, you can't answer your question. And I urge you to read the rest of the book where I go through and talk about all of those issues and why they led to the leadership changes.
And Kevin Rudd, obviously, was a very difficult man to work for, and we know that. We know that he had a very short temper. We know that he treated his senior bureaucrats very poorly and often didn't give ministers the respect that they felt they deserved. One senior government figure actually said, well, you know what, so he's an arsehole. So what? He's still the person that people elected. Is it not true, basically, when you look at it, that... he was forced to delay the carbon pollution reduction scheme, the emissions trading scheme, because Julia Gillard, who he subsequently supported as a prime minister, wouldn't back him in a double dissolution on it. He then put his skin in the game with the mining tax that you came up with. And then when that couldn't be sold and the mining industry ran a massive campaign against the government... You basically put a bullet in the back of his head and said, you're going to wear this, mate, and I'm going to jump ship and become Treasurer and Deputy Prime Minister to Julia Gillard and come up with a new mining tax that has not raised any money. It's gone from $6.5 billion dollars.
Well, can we go through all of those things?
Sure.
Because none of that is true.
Right.
And that is one of the reasons why I wrote the book. Right. I go through in great detail.
Some people
would
say it's actually history, and that is what happened.
That's right. And I cite all the key documents and I cite all the key meetings when it comes to the emissions trading scheme, both one and two. I go through the whole development of the mining tax and its evolution from the Henry Report. All that is done in very great detail, Joe. So I urge you to read it all because
I've read the ABC fact-check version, which has it going.
We are running out of time, so just very, very quickly, Mr. Swan, got to ask, sitting back now that you're no longer Treasurer, watching Joe Hockey, you must have a bit of a giggle at times.
Look, it's true that it's the second toughest job and sometimes the toughest job in the country, but Joe's problems aren't salesmanship. They're the substance of the budget, and that's the problem.
Do you think when you see him, you go, I put up with it for 5 years.
No, I'm a patriot. I want to see our country do well. I mean, I've got a very big difference with Joe Hockey. He goes around talking about an economic emergency and talking our country down. When we don't have an economic emergency, we have a AAA credit rating. They're trying to use that as cover to get out of their election promises and inflict a lot of pain. That's the problem I have with Joe Hockey, its impact on the country.
All right. Well, the former Treasurer's Wayne Swan's new book, The Good Fight, is out today. It's published by Allen and Unwin. Everyone thank Wayne Swan. So you didn't send him a good luck tweet?
Send him a copy of the book?
No. Well, I could do that.